chosen. So let's place ourselves in God's presence. Jeremiah 31:31. Very famous. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The reading from the book of the prophet Jeremiah. The days are coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant I made with their fathers, the day I took them by the hand to lead them forth from the land of Egypt. For they broke my covenant, and I had to show myself their master, says the Lord. But this is the covenant which I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will place my law within them and write it upon their hearts. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer will they need to teach their friends and kinsmen how to know the Lord. All from least to greatest shall know me, says the Lord, for I will forgive their evil doing and remember their sins no more. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Okay, so why did I choose that? What was that word?
Covenant.
And we're going to see and hear a lot about covenant over the next 5 weeks. So welcome to this class. We want to welcome, of course, our St. Anne's parishioners, but particularly any visitors we have. And if you're a visitor and you're not a St. Anne's parishioner, do you mind raising your hand so we can say hello to you? Okay. Mainly from Nativity, but also from St. Francis of Assisi. And some of you are people that come here often because you've been with me in other classes. And so thank you for being here. Just as a heads up, Bill Pettit, do some of you know Bill Pettit? From IC, from the cathedral. He's one of the core parishioners at the cathedral, and he's in the permanent diaconate class, and he's on vacation, or he would be here, and he promised to bring a bunch of Protestants with him, which I'm looking forward to, because he has a little group, he meets with some Protestants periodically, and they talk about stuff, and I'm his spiritual director, because he needs one for being in the permanent diaconate program, and of course, when I was a deacon, and when I was in town and did my deacon work at the cathedral, so I know him from that. His brother Chuck Pettit is one of our parishioners here. He does a lot of catering around the house. And his other brother Chris is the one that does all the lawn work and things that you hear on the radio from time to time, those little announcements on AM radio. But anyway, so we're hoping that next week when he comes back off his vacation, he'll bring his Protestant friends with us. Because when I used to teach these classes up at Holy Angels, we used to average about 33 people in the class, and three of them were Presbyterians, and always kind of liked that. They were always some of our best students, and they brought another perspective to everything. So anyway, welcome. Those of you who know me know that in the first class, I always set a bunch of ground rules, and the first ground rule is that you have to enjoy yourself while you learn. You know, you will enjoy yourself or else. And so we want this to be a user-friendly course. We'll be here for 5 weeks for 2 hours at a time, 10 hours. If you're here for all the 10, you get your 10 credit hours from Sister Kathy towards the, any kind of certification you need for teaching, and particularly for the Bible certificate that she offers, the certificate of biblical studies. We here at St. Anne's, in case you don't know, she talked me into doing that for her, so over a 3-year period, I have to offer enough Bible courses so you can get all the credits you need for the certificate, which means that I'll be doing 3 Bible classes a year, one in the spring, one in the summer, and one in the fall. And so so if you're interested in that biblical certification thing, you'll be able to pick it one up. We've already done Psalms, we've already done Mark, and we've done a course in Paul, a short course in Paul. Now we're doing this basic course, which is supposed to kick it all off, which she's calling a Catholic overview of the Old and the New Testaments. Okay? Now with the ground rules, since we'll try to stick to 2 hours at a time, I need a couple of people to volunteer to be our timekeepers, who will let me know when it's time for me to shut up. Everything like that. Maybe give me a timeout signals. So who would like to be? We need two. We always need a primary and a backup because we know that something's going to happen during the 5 weeks and you're going to get a head cold or something. Or the grandkids. Okay, Marjorie, you'll be the primary one. Who would like to be the backup?
I'll be the backup.
Okay, good, okay. And what we'll do is we'll go for 55 minutes. We'll try to start as best we can around 7, if you all agree to that. We'll wait if you want to. I mean, I'll stay here as long as you want. But, you know, some of you may want to go home around 9 o'clock. Okay. So we'll try to start around 7 on time. And then at 55 minutes into the class, Marjorie's going to go, and we'll do a 5-minute break, which will allow me to head to the men's room. And if you don't know where the men's room is, go out this corridor. As far as you can, make a right-hand turn, and if you hold it, you'll walk right into the women's room. And if you're a man, it's the room next to it. So don't get the rooms confused. But go in the right room. That's probably the most important thing I'll tell you. So yeah. During the class, feel free to get up, get a cup of coffee, a glass of water. Greg was kind enough to bring some cookies tonight. If you want to bring other things to help share with the class, you're certainly welcome to do so. You don't have to do it. But we want this thing to be nice and easy and friendly. If you're like me and have a bad back, if during the class you need to get up and walk around the room, that's fine. Do that. Do whatever it needs to make this as enjoyable as you can. And also to be a situation where, well, we're going to learn. And unfortunately, to only spend 10 hours and do justice to an overview of the entire Bible is probably impossible. Yes. As a starter. So, you know, well, I mentioned before that one of the important words, and why I picked that, those words from Jeremiah. By the way, if you've ever been one of my parishioners, you know Jeremiah's my man. I'm the man from the Old Testament. I love Jeremiah. Anyway, you know, Jeremiah, you could really feel for him. He always wore his heart on his sleeve. You know exactly what he was thinking, what he was doing. And that was not the case with a lot of the prophets. They just give you, thus says the Lord God, you give the oracle. But Jeremiah always lets you know how he feels all the time. So then we get this word, covenant, which we're going to see over and over and over again as we work our way through this thing we call the Bible. Now, a covenant, just a brief overview, because we'll keep coming back to this all the time, of course, is a pact or an agreement. It's something that creates a relationship. Between a person and another person or a group. Between me and you. So the first thing I want to do in this class is I want to create a covenant with all of you. Okay? Just like we heard in that reading from Jeremiah where God says, I will be your God and you will be my people. I will be your leader or guide, teacher if you will, through the Bible. And you will be my student. Okay? I will try to introduce you to a lot of things that maybe you've never heard before. Or weren't aware of, or maybe were aware of, but need reinforcing. Because we can never do this enough. As much time as I've spent, and CJ can tell you, just with this course, I spent hours. This whole book is my notes from looking at things and hearing things and reading things. I don't begin to say that I'm a biblical scholar. I'm a biblical student. But in this relationship, I'm going to play the role of the leader and the teacher. Okay? And you do that. And what I'm going to do is tell you that when you leave here today after the first 2 hours, you're not going to be an expert in the Old or New Testament. Okay? When you leave at the end of the 5th week, you're not going to know everything either. But you'll get your learner's permit. And then in that last week, you'll have a graduation, so don't forget to go to Dollar Tree and get your cap and gown for the last week. And you get your certificates, and we have like a little party and a celebration and a festival, and we'll take the fatted calf and whatever, do whatever else we need to do with that, okay? So I will try to give you a new tool set. The idea is to introduce you to some of these things so that you can go back and for the rest of your life read through the Bible and maybe use some of these tools that we'll be introduced to get a deeper appreciation for what sacred scripture is all about. Okay, I'm going to try to do that. That's going to be my part of the bargain, the pact, the agreement. Okay, I want you to trust me. try to prove that I'm trustworthy, that I know a little bit about what I'm talking about. Okay? And I want you to trust. You know, some of you know I'm a big Stephen Covey guy. In fact, the other day, somebody gave me a $25 gift certificate to Barnes & Noble, and I bought Covey's book from last year called the third Alternative. Okay? But I used to teach Stephen Covey when I taught at State Tech, his principle-centered leadership book and everything. So anyway, so he says that trust is the cement that holds all relationships together. And if a covenant is something to do with a relationship, okay, your part of the bargain is to trust me and not despair and give up. And my part is to try to introduce you to some of these concepts and ideas so that you can have a better appreciation for the Bible. Are you willing? Now, usually what happens with a covenant, all the people say, yes, we will do whatever God says. So, well, yes, will you do what I say?
Yes, Father.
So now we have this covenant, okay? Now, when you get a chance to read through it, and I can't remember if I picked that part of Genesis for us to read. Remember, God makes a covenant with Abraham, right? And at one point, Abraham takes a bunch of these animals and he cuts them up into pieces. And he makes a couple rows, right? And he walks between them. So what was that all about? That was a symbolic gesture that said, hey, Abraham, if you don't keep your part of this covenant, see those cut up pieces of things? Expect that. Because you see, in a covenant, it's assumed, once you agree to the covenant, that you're going to comply with your part of the bargain. Or else there are going to be consequences to pay. Now, here, there's not going to be much in the way of consequences. It just means that, you're not going to take whatever we get here and use it. So you're not going to lose anything. Okay? So no, you're not going to be cut up into pieces, like the example of pieces of animals and things like that. But anyway, this is the whole idea. I just want to kind of introduce you to this idea of covenant, and that we have a covenant too for this thing. Now, I'm going to ask one of my lovely assistants. And another lovely assistant, if they would be kind enough to pass out the agenda for tonight. Because I thought you might want to know what it is we're going to try to do tonight. I don't know how far we'll get. But if you look at it already, you'll see we've done a couple things. We've had the opening prayer and welcome. We've done the ground rules. And we've created our own covenant between you and me, between I and you. Okay? I, thou, covenant. Oh, by the way, often in these covenants, one person is the superior and the other is kind of the inferior, if you will. Some person has the upper hand on the power, okay? And the other person doesn't. And there's a special name given to that, and you'll see this when you read books. It's called a suzerainty covenant. And now, in our covenant, we can say that's not the case, because we're both human beings. But when it comes to God and Israel, that is a suzerainty covenant, because God's God and Israel's not. Okay, and so usually when one is the powerful person, the other person is a weaker person, it's called a suzerainty, S-U-Z-R-E-N-I-T-Y. Okay? Now if you look at the thing, we talk about course title. And I got a couple of these up here if you don't have them. Sister Kathy prints out of the office of catechesis little certificate program brochures. And there's one for biblical studies. And it tells you what you've got to take in order to get it, how many hours you need, 150 hours, and how they're broken up into different sections. And one of the courses she calls a Catholic Bible Overview. That's the course that you're in for 10 hours. And it says, Catholic Bible Overview of Old and New Testaments. Now, that's where it stopped in the old brochure. In the new brochure, she says, comma, including dogmatic, constitutional, and divine revelation. Wow, okay? So that divine revelation business, the constitutional divine revelation, is where the Catholic kind of flavor to the biblical things come about. That constitution has a name. It's called Dei Verbum. Dei Verbum, which is two Latin words, both from the second declension of nouns in Latin. Verbum verbi means word, it's neuter, second declension. And Deus Dei, second declension masculine, means God. And since it's genitive, means of God. So it literally means the word of God. And as you know, when the Second Vatican Council met in the 60s, originally Pope John the 23rd called it to open up the windows, he said, and let some fresh air into the church. He died, of course, before it was over, and Paul the 6th concluded the council. When they put out a document, and it was a document that was very, very important, they called it a constitution, just like our constitution for our country. And they called these different documents by the first two words of whatever the document is. In this case, Dei Verbum are the first two words of the document. Okay. But it's the dogmatic constitution on divine revelation. Now, I'm going to come back to that in a second. Now, I told you that Dei Verbum, that the word of God, right? Now, this is where I was hoping our Protestants would be here, okay? Now, best laid plans of mice and men often go astray. But we have somebody that used to be a Protestant. Now, probably still remembers the way Protestant Christians think. If I were to say to a Protestant, the word of God, what would a Protestant say?
Are you talking about the Bible?
The Bible.
The Bible.
Or what we might call SS. And I don't mean Secret Service or the Nazis or anything like that. Sacred Scripture. That is the word of God. Now, all the rest of you, including Larry, is a Catholic. Now, I want to ask you Catholics, what is the Word of God? Would you tell me the same thing?
Scripture and tradition.
Okay. Yeah, okay. You would say Sacred Scripture, right? But you wouldn't stop there. They would stop, because they would use then a Latin phrase, sola scriptura. Scripture alone. Only Scripture. Okay? Catholic would say, no, Sacred Scripture and Sacred Tradition. Okay? Sacred Tradition. The teaching that Jesus handed on orally to his apostles. Now, we believe, now, in fact, I'll come back in a second. Okay? And if you're a thinking Catholic, you don't stop there. Sacred Scripture and Sacred Tradition and
history.
Well, that's who gives us the Sacred Tradition. And
Gospel and sacraments.
And
the teachings of the Church.
Who said that? Jesus Christ is the Word of God. You hear it all. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Okay? For a Catholic, all of divine revelation is summed up in a person called Jesus Christ. He's the fulfillment of everything. Now, we believe that sacred scripture and sacred tradition are like two sides of a coin, or like looking at one another in the mirror. They reflect one another. Sacred tradition is what wrote the sacred scriptures. In other words, that Christianity existed before there ever was an NT. Because when those people who were writing those things that became the NT said that Jesus died in accordance with the scriptures, they did not mean Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. They meant what? Well, we today call the Old Testament, which they would not call the Old Testament. They would say that was their sacred scriptures, the Hebrew sacred scriptures, the Hebrew. And we're going to tell you what the Hebrews call that here in a little bit. We're working towards that. Okay? So that was what sacred scripture was for St. Paul. That's what sacred scripture was for St. Peter and St. John and everybody else. It was those books that we today call the Old Testament. So the sacred tradition created the sacred scripture, not the other way around. But if we were to, again, ask the Protestant, I'm afraid we have to keep asking you to play the role of the Protestant. Okay? What are you a people of? They would say what?
The book.
We're a people of the book. We ask a Catholic, who are you a person of, people of? We would say, of a person. Jesus Christ. It's a different view of divine revelation. Okay. So now, sorry about that, Larry. You had to fill in for the Bill's group that's not here tonight. But anyway, so this is what's going on here, and this is what we're coming to take a look at. Now, let's get back to De Verbum, the document. What I just did, kind of in my own feeble way here, is what De Verbum tells you if you go to read it. And it's worth reading it. If you never read it before, it's one of the documents from Vatican II. This is all the documents, essentially, from Vatican. Okay. De Verbum is not that long, although it's not a short little, it's not like the third letter of John or something, and it's about how it begins, it ends, kind of a thing. But it's the Dogmatic Constitutional and Divine Revelation, and it's dated 18 November 1965. And I thought I would just kind of let my fingers do the walking through the, it's kind of yellow pages. And go back through what some of the things that it actually says in its own words. You can Google this. Google, I guess, is in a lot of trouble right now. I mean, lawsuits and stuff, aren't they? Kind of thing. But anyway, Google it, and you can go to Dei Verbum, and this will show up. So you don't have to go out and buy a book if you don't want to, and you might sit there and read it. Okay. But Paragraph 1 just talks about what we're going to do. We're writing this dogmatic constitution. Paragraph 2, it says, it pleased God in his goodness and wisdom to reveal himself, to make known the mystery of his will. Okay, that's divine revelation. Okay. And he does this, paragraph 2 says, by deeds and words. Now, Jesus did it a lot by his deeds. God did it in the Old Testament by his deeds, too. He intervened in history. The Exodus and things like that, okay? And then words, eventually what became sacred scripture, okay? Paragraph 3. Yeah, it provides men with constant evidence of himself in created realities, okay? And it goes through in paragraph 3, talks about Abraham and Moses and the prophets and stuff like that, okay? And then it says, after that, God spoke many times and in various ways through the prophets. In these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son. Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 to 2. Before he sent his Son. Fulfillment of all revelation. Okay? And then 5, it talks about obedience by faith and things like that. Okay? And then in paragraph 6, it says, the sacred synod, which means this Vatican II, professes that God, the first principle and the last end of all things, the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega,
okay,
can be known with certainty from the created world. You can know that God exists from the created world.
Okay.
By the natural light of human reason. Okay, but he needs revelation that those things which in themselves are not beyond the grasp of human reason can, in the present condition of the human race, be known by all. In other words, there are certain things about God that we cannot know by reason. What would some of those be?
Trinity.
Three persons in one God. How do we know that? Jesus said, go out, the Great Commission at the end of Matthew, and baptize in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Jesus revealed that to us. There's no way in human reason you can come up to that, and there's no way with human reason you can give a totally good explanation. You know, St. Patrick tried with the shamrock, and I try with water being in various, or H2O, and all that. But you just can't know it. Okay? He did that, okay? Transmission of divine revelation, number 7. Christ the Lord, in whom the entire revelation of the Most High God is summed up. See 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20, chapter 3, verse 16, to chapter 4, verse 6. Okay? And it talks about the spreading of the gospel and everything else like that. Okay? And that tradition that comes from the apostles and makes progress in the church with the help of the Holy Spirit. And that's where the magisterium comes in, the teaching arm of the church, which makes sure that we stay within the sacred tradition passed to the apostles, is this thing called the magisterium. You remember a couple years ago, there was a movie with Tom Cruise's former wife, before this one. I can't think of her name. The Australian. Okay. Remember the bad people, and it was called the magisterium. Sacred tradition and sacred scripture, then, and this is paragraph 9, are bound closely together and communicate one with the other. Sacred Scripture is the speech of God as it is put down in writing under the breath of the Holy Spirit. That breath of the Holy Spirit has a fancy name. It's called, right? Inspiration. Inspire. To breathe, literally breathe into. Okay. So that's it. Okay. And tradition transmits in its entirety the Word of God, which has been entrusted to the apostles by Christ the Lord and the Holy Spirit. Thus it comes about that the church does not draw her certainty about all revealed truths from the Holy Scriptures alone. Hence, both Scripture and tradition must be accepted and honored with equal feelings of devotion and reverence. Paragraph 10. Sacred tradition and sacred Scripture make up a single sacred deposit of the Word of God. We often refer to it as the deposit of faith. So you get the idea. And this thing goes on with this kind of a thing. It also talks about interpretation. We're going to talk a lot about interpretation probably each week, okay, of different things. And it talks, starting with paragraphs 11 and 12, about how important it is to try to figure out what the author of those books intended, realizing that they all lived at a different time than we live, spoke a different language than we speak, had customs that most of us today don't even know about anymore, okay? It's all reflected in what they said and how they said it. So that in sacred scripture, there's always two authors. There's the Holy Spirit, there's God inspiring the writer, whoever it was, he or she, whoever wrote it. Okay. And we're going to find out that many of these books were written and then rewritten and then written again, edited over a period of a long period of time. Okay? So there's that human element in the writings, but there's also that divine element, the Holy Spirit inspiring the person. But the person's going to be constrained by their knowledge, their abilities. Some were better writers than others, their customs, the times they came from, everything else. So in paragraphs 11 and 12 of De Verum, it talks about how, for example, literary forms, for the fact is that truth is differently presented and expressed in the various types of historical writing in prophetical and poetic texts and so forth. Now, we're going to find out that some of these stories, by the virtue of the form that they're written in, have a great deal of impact on the meaning of them. They're going to be type stories. I mentioned one this morning at the Fishers of Men. We're going to find out that there's a type story about finding your wife. You leave home, go on a journey, you meet somebody by a well. And she or you draw water. And then you go and have a meal together, and the next thing you know, you're betrothed. Okay? Right, that's how it works. Abraham's servant did it for Isaac. You know, notice Isaac doesn't appear much in the Old Testament. But a lot about Abraham, a lot about Jacob, a lot about Joseph. But this Isaac guy kind of gets glossed over, doesn't he? And you find he's a very passive character if you read the scriptures really well. In fact, he doesn't even go to do it. Isaac. Oh, Ike. You know, not Ike, Isaac. But anyway, he doesn't go. In fact, Abraham has to send a servant to go find the wife for Isaac. You know, remember? Isaac and Rebecca and stuff. And anyway, he doesn't go. But Jacob does, right? Finds, you know, his wife at the well, and then he gets tricked into having another wife and all that kinds of stuff. Moses, remember? Moses goes to a well, and he fights off the Amalekites, and there's seven daughters there, and one of them winds up being his wife. And they go home to daddy, Jethro, and Jethro says, how did you come home so quick today? Well, there was this Egyptian guy that showed up and, you know, warded off all these terrible guys who were trying to take over all the water. And he says, well, where is he? Why didn't you bring him home? It's a possible son-in-law for me. Go get that guy. Bring him back. And so they bring him back, and he marries one of Jethro's daughters. Okay? And so you see this. This is a type story that happens often in ancient literature. And it happens to these patriarchs over the course of time. And so that you get a better insight into that. And as I mentioned this morning, you can even read Jesus' meeting with the Samaritan woman in the well. It's this type of story, but they're very, they don't get married. But she becomes a believer, doesn't she? So spiritually she becomes married, because in the Christian tradition, you know, marriage between a man and woman is a mystery. I mean, I'm talking about Christ and the church, right? Christ and the church is like a marriage, right? And so, if she becomes one of Jesus' followers, we're not calling it the church yet, and she gets all these other people into it. Remember, even during the story, remember some the disciples come and say, hey, Jesus, you know, did you eat something? You know, so even this element about having some food appears in the story. It's marvelous if you can recognize that type story in the story, that kind of a thing. So anyway, it talks about stuff like that, and it goes into the Old Testament. With, you know, and we'll just keep talking about some of the ideas, but you get the idea. I don't want to keep on going because we need to get going a little bit. We'll never get through week one by the end. But anyway, so that's the idea. So if you were going to read the Meribim and could draw it up on your computer, I would take particularly look at paragraph 10, 12, 21, and 25. Now that gets us through the first six items in our agenda for today. Is everybody still with me? Okay. And then I'll talk about covenants and sacred scripture. That SS means sacred scripture. Typically the covenant is exactly what I try in my feeble way to give with you. I, thou, me, you. We're going to agree to this thing back and forth. But throughout sacred scripture, when you think about it, there are all kinds of these agreements. And they typically follow this pattern. Sometimes they don't necessarily follow this pattern, but you could say that the first covenant in the Bible is with Adam and Eve, isn't it? God says, I'm God, I'm giving you this Garden of Eden, and you're to tend it and take care of it, you're going to have an idyllic life, and everything. Oh, by the way, don't eat from that tree. Right? And of course, what happens? You got to eat from that tree. Don't say don't eat from that tree, because that just is an invitation to go ahead and do it in human nature. Right? And so, you have the first parents, the fall, original sin, and all that. And they get thrown out of the garden, right? So usually, with a covenant, there's this agreement. Typically, God is keeping his part of the agreement, but the other person or persons, Israel, doesn't, right? And there's going to be that reckoning, just like Abraham walking through those cut up carcasses of animals. Okay? There's going to be that. But then what has happened? God does something to take everybody back. Those of you who are going go to daily mass know that we're reading from Hosea. And his life is like a cartoon for this whole pattern. He marries a prostitute. Her name is Gomer, not Pyle. Gomer. And she can't, she track record is to be a prostitute, so she becomes unfaithful to him. There's a question about, are the kids really his kids or not his kids? You know? So what does Hosea do? Takes her back. Every time. He loves her. He can't help but take her back. So what does she do? Same thing. Unfaithful, right? And this is the pattern between human beings and God throughout what we call salvation history. We don't keep our part of the bargain. And somehow or another, there's punishment. It's just like going to confession, you know? We have to admit we're sorry. There's some punishment. In confession, it winds up being three Our Fathers and three Hail Marys, but, you know, you got a penance to do. Okay? And you're restored. Restoration. Right? And that's what these covenant things do. So you got Adam and Eve, they fail. Then you got the human race, right? And the human race is destroyed after the Tower of Babel or Babel. Either pronunciation is acceptable, apparently. And, and Noah, right? God creates a covenant with Noah, which is represented by what? The rainbow. I will never destroy the earth again by water. But of course, then, Noah gets drunk and two of the sons, a symbolic gesture. Things fall apart as always, right? And so those first 11 chapters in Genesis wind up being God dealing with sort of the human race, right? And that all fails. So he says, aha, I'll pick a man, Abram, and I'll make a covenant with him. And the sign of the covenant is what? Circumcision. Right? That's the reason why Paul has such a problem with those first Jewish Christians, because he's bringing all these Gentiles in who have not been circumcised. You know, and these adults don't want to get circumcised for good reason. and everything, and he has to fight with the Jerusalem establishment. They had the first council of Jerusalem, right? Where Paul says the Gentiles don't have to be circumcised to still be part of Israel, God's people. Okay, but anyway, we're back to Abraham. So we have a covenant with Abraham, and then Isaac and Jacob, and next thing you know, got a clan. And then the next big covenant happens with what? Moses, huh? The Paschal Lamb, the unleavened bread, the Exodus, those kinds of things. And we'll go through the book, the first five books of the Old Testament, and the Torah and stuff, and you'll see that. But they're always breaking that, aren't they? All the time. Okay. And then God says, okay, I'll make it David. And David says, hey, I want to build a house for the Ark of the Covenant. And God says, no, but I'll build you a house. Right? So the Davidic covenant. There'll be somebody from David's loins on the throne. Didn't quite work out that way because what? They're always falling away. Until that Davidic covenant is fulfilled in Jesus. And we have that new covenant. And that's the reason why the early church loved Jeremiah 31:31. They didn't know it as Jeremiah 31:31, because as you'll learn, there were no chapters and there were no verses. So when Jesus picked up that scroll of Isaiah in the synagogue in Nazareth and opened it up to the exact place where he wanted to quote from, that meant he could really read. He could read good. He was a scholar, a lot like Luke. He could find it. Okay? Because there was no chapters, no verses. chapters come in with Stephen Langton in the 13th century AD, Archbishop Canterbury. And then in the Renaissance, an Italian printer put the verses in. That was the first time there were chapters and verses. And so, you know, these things, so these covenants are going on all the time throughout this thing we're calling the Old and the New Testament, culminating in Jesus Christ, the new covenant. Okay? So let's mention that. Okay. Now, this thing we call Old and New Testament, we give a name, and we call it the Bible, don't we? Now, it just so happens that the word Bible comes from two Greek words. Ta, Biblia. Do I have that down?
Yes.
Yeah, I do. How about that? I did that for you. I'm just so nice. Ta, Biblia. And it's plural. So, Ta, Biblia, better translation in English is the books, the library, okay? Realizing that this library has a unity to it. Okay, and that's the reason why you can get away with calling it the good book. But it's really a whole series of books and different types of books and books written over centuries and books that were composed and edited and changed and things were moved and things were dropped and things were added over the course of time to get to the form that they're in today. But it'd be better to think of the Bible as the books, the library. You got all these different kind of books in there. Okay? We talked a little bit about inspiration right now already. But let's talk about this word covenant itself. Comes from a Hebrew word that a lot of you know, and you may not know that you know it. Does anybody know the Hebrew word for covenant? Do you ever hear the phrase B'nai B'rith?
Yeah.
It means the children of the covenant. B-R-T-H. Now remember that Hebrew has no vowels until modern time. So that if the consonants carry the meaning of the word, an actual word, if we were to write it in English, would be berith or berith. Okay? That means covenant in Hebrew. This agreement, this pact, this thing that creates a relationship between two parties. Okay. Now, like I said, it's B'nai B'rith. Now, think about how difficult it would be if you've got a document with no vowels in it. And for example, let's just take an English word. H-L-L. What word is that?
Hill.
Hill?
Hill.
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 Let's start with the letter A-E-I-O-U. Could be hall. Could be hell. Don't want to talk about that. Could be hill. There could be hole, misspelled. Okay. Could be hall. Yeah, could be hello. It could be heel. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It could be all those things. Can you imagine, you know, how difficult it must be to translate Hebrew sometimes? And these things are all strung across without any spaces between them. You've got to cut the words up, figure out what the vowels are supposed to be, and everything else.
Well, how'd they get covenant out of that?
What's the English word covenant? Okay, we say the English word covenant means a pact or an agreement between two people. But the Hebrew word, it's not, you're not doing it like a B for C kind of thing. You translate one word from one language into another language.
So they just figured, okay, we're just
going to
make
it. In English, we know what a pact or agreement is. That's a covenant. Okay?
Yeah,
now, the problem is, Diatheke in Greek was what the people who translated, remember what they said, two agenda, oh, time's up. Okay, 5-minute break, we'll be back.